talk about this a little bit and the potential backlash from it that Adam brought up. We have the economist Dave Maney here with us in the studio. You know, I think there's something to what Adam Garcia Dave is talking about, that this, I know the steel and aluminum thing, us included, as everybody worked up and talking about it, trade, but this is the big one, China, intellectual property. What do you make of it?
I think it definitely is. I mean, we're moving to an economy that's powered by creativity and innovation and knowledge. It's not powered by steel.
Right.
So you can think of the steel thing as it's like the flashbang grenade, right? I'm going to throw the thing that's flashy first. It would have been nice, as your earlier guest said, if it was kind of a little more targeted of a flash grenade.
Well, maybe this was first. I mean, even though it is bigger, because it would be more targeted just going after China. I mean, there's not really much debate that they are guilty of intellectual property theft, right? That they're, you know, robbing us blind here. Billions and hundreds of billions of dollars is the estimate per year. But as Adam's reporting points out, some of his analysts said, question is, what do you do about it? How strong can you be, and what does China do in response?
It's a much slipperier topic, right? An aluminum ingot you can hold in your hand, or sheet steel or rolled steel or whatever, but now you're talking about ideas and code and the basis, the underlying basis, or the look and feel. I mean, intellectual property is a vast umbrella. You can't intercept it at the border. It's a much harder thing to put your arms around.
But if we all agree they're doing it, right? We all agree, and everybody, every single person I've interviewed this week has agreed that China's doing something wrong. We have all kinds of debates about the merits of tariffs. What do we do about these kinds of things?
What I think the president's doing right is kind of something that's kind of analogous to what's gone on with North Korea, which is, you know, there's tough talk with a feeling of possible action. And he's known to be a great fan of Richard Nixon's madman theory, which is make them think I'm crazy and then send in the reasonable guys to do the negotiation. I think there's a piece of that going on. But I also think that there's this longstanding history of the president's fundamental misunderstanding of what
There's definitely a longstanding history. Some people agree with him, some disagree. You obviously do. But he has been like this for years. And, you know, I know you talked in the past about making an analogy to our minimum wage debate, which I think is interesting. It's another economic debate we have all the time. And people get stuck on it. And you think this is happening again, don't you?
It's absolutely happening. Here's how this is like a minimum wage thing. People on the left, or those adherents to more left economic beliefs, will say, well, you can just change this one thing. We can require this one thing and everything else will stay the same. So we could require that you have to pay workers $15 an hour, and trust me, prices won't change. And it's just baloney.
Right.
Here's the same thing. We could just slap on a 15 to 20% tariff and nothing will change. Well, that's not true. You're going to tick people off on the other side. You're going to cause prices to jump. It sets off, as you know, a giant chain reaction.
Well, that's the fear.
Unanticipated events, which happens to the left every time they make a change like that. And here we have a president who nominally stands on the right thinking, I can just laser shoot this thing.
Well, the other thing is people identify with the arguments in similar fashions. That you look at someone, you know, working the fast food industry, for example, or whatever industry is paying minimum wage, you say, in your heart of hearts, you might say to yourself, you know, that's not fair. They deserve to make more. They don't make a living wage. You identify with that. But then when you think about it in terms of economics, the thoughts might be different. So it's a tough argument to come back against, I guess, is my point.
Yeah, it is, except that you go back to the thing that all things in economics are interconnected. You cannot change one without the other. It's like a balloon. You squeeze it here, you might want to say, well, I want to compress it, but that little bubble pops out on the other side, and that bubble is usually not a good bubble.
No, I hear you. Final thing, where do you think Trump is on all this, the president? Because we just heard him in his cabinet meeting, right, talking about exemptions. So we're talking going back to steel and aluminum now for Canada, Mexico. He mentioned Australia, mentioned, quote, other countries. So maybe he's softening a little bit. Adam tells us this China thing could be real, real serious in terms of the amount of dollars added to that. Where is he? I mean, he's a protectionist for years, so he really believes in this. This has been my point all week long. You think he moderates a bit, or?
Yeah, look, my gut says on this intellectual property thing, we could use a little stiffer spine, like a little bigger baseball bat, and I think he's bringing that. I don't think he thinks at the same strategic level that Richard Nixon did, so, you know, I'm a little bit less comfortable with that, but.
Maybe should have done that first.
Yeah.
You know? It was like we argued with tax cuts at the time. People said, oh, you should have went with that first instead of healthcare and everything else. The timing sometimes matters in politics. Good to see you, Dave.
Good to see you, Colin.
All right, good discussion.